Rotarians, veterans, and guests to the 2016 Southwest Metro Rotary Veterans Luncheon. I'm Mark Hegstrom, your district governor for Rotary 5950 and a member of the Edina Morningside Rotary Club. Thank you for joining us at this special event. It's a pleasure to come together today and enjoy fellowship with our honored veterans and Rotarians from 8 Rotary Clubs from Area 3 in the Southwest Metro area. Rotarians, please give a cheer when we call your club's name. Bloomington Daymakers. All right, yeah. Bloomington Noon. All right. Eden Prairie AM. Eden Prairie Noon. Oh, Edina. All right, Edina Morningside. Woo, all right. Richfield. And South Metro Minneapolis Evenings. Where are they? Ah! All right, we're delighted to have retired Brigadier General Dennis Schulstad today as our MC. Dennis Schulstad has had dual careers, one in the military and one in politics. He is a retired Air Force Brigadier General and also was for 22 years an elected member of the Minneapolis City Council. He has been a consultant for numerous campaigns ranging from U.S. Senate to governor to legislature. He recently served as the national president of the 62,000 member University of Minnesota Alumni Association. The Secretary of Defense appointed him to be Minnesota State Chair and Employer Support of the Guard and Reserve, a position he held for over 7 years. He was selected to be a member of the Civic Leader Advisory Group to the Air Force Chief of Staff. Denny is a co-founder and board president of the Minnesotans Military Appreciation Fund, which has raised over $16 million to distribute to Minnesota members of the armed forces who have served in combat after 9/11. Please welcome Dennis Schulstad.
Well, thank you, Mark. You know, nearly a century ago, we were fighting in World War I. Remember, that was the war to end all wars. If only it had been that way. Wouldn't that have been wonderful? Because wars are terrible. They're to be avoided whenever possible. But it seems that there always have been wars and conflicts, and there always will be. We're a peace-loving nation that's been in existence for 250 years. And during that time, we've had a dozen wars. Well, on the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month, and that would have been half an hour ago, the armistice was signed to end World War I. And then they celebrated Armistice Day to honor and to thank all those veterans from that war. But in 1954, President Eisenhower said, "We will now call it Veterans Day, and it will be to celebrate and honor and thank all of the veterans from the past and all of the people who are serving at this time." Every veteran has made huge sacrifices to defend our nation. Each has taken an oath that they will protect and defend our nation even at the risk of their life and limb. So today, we recognize and honor all of the veterans, past and current. In 1902, when we had the Rotary Luncheon, there was one guest here, Adriana Vorgenbruggen. He was the guest of Dan Barnett. She had graduated from Wayzata High School as an honor student. She went to the United States Air Force Academy, and she was here very proudly wearing her Air Force uniform as a brand new second lieutenant. She stayed in the Air Force. She became a major. And a few months ago in Afghanistan, she was killed by a suicide bomber. That's the reason we're here today, is to remember people like that. She is now buried at Arlington National Cemetery. She was 36 years old. Every Rotary member lives a special theme, a special saying, and that is service above self. That's true for every Rotary member. That's true for every veteran. At this time, please rise for the presentation of colors by the Chanhassen American Legion Post number 580. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Order.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which we stand, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Left, faith, forward, march.
And now the Rotary Brass Quintet, under the direction of Mary Brindle, the past president of the Edina Morningside Rotary and recently re-elected member of the Edina City Council, will play the national anthem.
Oh, say, can you see where the dawn's early light? What so proudly we hail at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watch, were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there.
Seated. Lieutenant Colonel Chaplain Jerome Fenn will deliver our invocation. Father Fenn joined the National Guard in 1998. He's been a hospital chaplain for 30 years at Fairview and Methodist hospitals. He's a Catholic priest of the Archdiocese of St. Paul in Minneapolis. As a National Guard chaplain, Father Fenn has held multiple deployments to Bosnia, Iraq, and Croatia. He is the highest ranking priest in the Minnesota National Guard. Please welcome Chaplain Lieutenant Colonel Fenn.
Let us pray. Today we are here to honor those who have served and continue to serve our country. We need to be constantly reminded of our gift of freedom and of those who give their lives to make sure future generations continue to know life in a free society. These men and women who serve create a clear pathway for us to continue our freedom's journey. We seek to honor the mothers and fathers, the sons and daughters who have served and who are serving our country. We ask you to bless all who serve our nation. May their service time be rewarded in every way and receive blessings for their unselfish love. Provide them with your protection, your strength, your wisdom, your peace. May each of our veterans feel honored not just today, but every day. To our wounded veterans who deal with physical and emotional wounds, may they receive comfort and be healed. Let them know their sacrifices mean so much to us. Let us not forget them. We ask this in your name. Amen.
Thanks to Bear Path Country Club for having this marvelous event today, and to the host chapter, the Eden Prairie Noon Rotary. Thank you very much. Every person here deserves to be introduced, because we have a lot of very special people here today. But there are some that I want to introduce so you know who's here. Please stand as your name is called, and please hold your applause until I'm done. We want you to meet the presidents of the Southwest Metro Rotary Clubs. From the Bloomington Daymakers is Debbie Belfry. Debbie, would you stand up, please? Okay, there we are, okay. A Bloomington Noon, Jeff Potts. Eden Prairie Morning, Janine Zeta. The Eden Prairie Noon, Rick Johnson. Edina, Ann Platt. Edina Morningside, Tom Gump. Richfield, Chip Growth. And the South Metro Minneapolis Evening Group, Krista Peterson. Thank you for your service. And we have some Rotary District dignitaries with us, and again, please hold your applause. The District Governor from Edina, Morningside, is Mark Hegstrom. Irene Kelly is the District Governor nominee from Eden Prairie Morning, and Tim Murphy is the past District Governor from Edina. Thank you for your leadership. We just finished a pretty tough campaign, and we still have some elected representatives with us today. No, I'm not talking about you, Senator. We have State Representative Yvonne Seltzer, State Representative Jennifer Loon, State Senator Ron Earhart, Edina Mayor Jim Hovland, and Edina City Council member and band leader, Mary Brindle. Now, I may well have missed some others. Are there any other elected representatives who I missed? If so, please stand up and introduce yourself. Okay, please give them a big round of applause. And we have a couple of generals with us today. General Gene Andriotti, I know you're here. And also General Paul Raycamp. Please stand. Welcome. Well, 75 years ago, we were in a war for our very survival. If we had lost that war to Hitler's Nazi Germany, we wouldn't be here today. Our entire nation rose up to fight the Nazi German threat. You couldn't buy a car because all of our manufacturing was making tanks and ships and airplanes. We were rationing gasoline, we were rationing food. We all gathered together to win that war. My dad was a World War II bomber pilot. After completing 25 missions, they said, "You should have been shot down by now." So they gave him a medal and sent him home. And I said, "Dad, you were a hero." And he said, "No, I wasn't a hero. I was a college student at the University of Minnesota, and I went off and served my country." Well, yes, Dad, you were a hero. You were a hero. And so were all of the people who served us in World War II. We have at least four World War II veterans with us today. And again, hold your applause, because we're going to want a good one when they're all introduced. Ed Bather, Harold Hansen, stand up if you can, or wave if you can. Mike Siddick, Edward Olson, and are there any that I have missed? Gentlemen, you are heroes. You not only saved America, you saved the world. A big round of applause for our World War II veterans. Almost every year we are honored to have our United States Senator Amy Klobuchar join us. She is one of only 20 female senators, and she's the first woman elected a United States Senator from the state of Minnesota. I worked with her when she was the Hennepin County attorney. I was always impressed with her knowledge of issues and her personable, caring attitude about all people. In these days when politicians are not always nice, this is one of the nicest people that we would ever want to meet. And I can tell you firsthand that veterans are well represented by Senator Klobuchar. When there's a missing medal, or there's a veteran in need, she is the one there to help. The senator has gained national recognition and respect. She's often mentioned as a potential president, vice president, Supreme Court justice, but we love you as a senator. She's won many awards. I'll mention a couple of them that she won for military work. One is from the Disabled American Veterans, who honored her work to improve the lives of American veterans. I'm a former state chairman of Employer Support of Garden Reserve, and we honored her with the Above and Beyond Award for the work that she did with her staff, who are members of our Guard and Reserve. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our senior senator and valued friend, Amy Klobuchar.
Danny, thank you so much. Thank you for your service. And I remember those days as county attorney. You were such a source of really teaching me about the military and everything and how it works. And it's just made such a difference for me now that I'm a U.S. Senator. It is really great to be out here with everyone. I just left our state veterans event, which was really nice this year. And Congressman Emmer was there and Senator Franken, and we were going to get on the same flight, but I had to come out here, and it did make me and wanted to come out here, and that's why I wanted to eat my lunch, and we just couldn't quite make that flight, but it reminded me of a hilarious moment with Al on a flight, actually. Since he's not here, I'll tell the story at his expense. When we were going from Washington to Minnesota, right after he had gotten elected about a year later, and Senator Coleman, as you know, and Al were in that big recount, and then it ended, and when it ended, a few senators took me into a room, and they said, you know, this is going to be a lot harder than you think. You know, you and Senator Coleman got along really well, and now you're going to have Al, and I go, well, we'll be fine. They go, no, no, you don't know what it's like having a celebrity as the other senator. And I'm like, no, it really will be fine, and one of them, Senator Schumer, said, well, I've had Hillary Clinton, it's not that easy, and Durbin is the other one. He said, well, I had Barack Obama, you have no idea what this is like. I go, what do you mean? They said, well, you walk into an airport, and you see in your own state, and someone says, hey, hey, and this, of course, has happened to me, and then you go, hi, and they said, could you take my picture with him? Okay, so this has happened quite a bit, and it all culminated on this flight going from D.C. to Minnesota, where we got on together, and the flight attendant was from Atlanta, a Delta flight attendant, and the crew was, but the whole plane was full of Minnesotans, and we get on, and she's very excited, and she gets on the microphone at the front of the plane and says, everyone, we have celebrities on the plane. Mr. and Mrs. Al Franken. Like, really? And so then he says, no, 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 ma'am, no, 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 no. She is actually the other senator from Minnesota. She then says, how cool is this? Husband and wife senators. Okay, so it really happened. You can check it. I put it in my book. Okay, so I am ready for anything. And it is great to be here with so many of you in Eden Prairie. I have fond memories of going to Eden Prairie when I was county attorney and then getting a little lost, okay, in those Eden Prairie way. And then I would end up at the police department. I'm sitting next to one of our friends from Bloomington, and I would always be like 15 minutes late. And they'd always say, did you get lost? And I'd be like, no. There's not a lot going on. But it is great to be here at this beautiful place and see many friends from the suburbs, and to see my friend, the mayor. I don't know where he is. And Mayor Hovland, I think, was here from Edina, right? Oh, there he is, right there. Very good. And the councilwoman, Representative Earhart, Representative Loon, Representative Seltzer. Thank you so much, the Gumper, whoever you are. Oh, there you are. I just liked when people said Gumper. I thought that would be, that'd be good if I would add that in there. And to see, hear about all your different clubs here, which is cool, your different Rotary clubs in the morning, in the noon, in the evening. And it's especially an honor to be here with all of our veterans. I think you know that every year we have Veterans Day right after Election Day. And as was noted, this year's election was not easy. It even, I would say, tested the bounds of our democracy. But here we are on the other side. And I think one of the wonderful things about today is that we can have a major focus not on what divides us, but what unites us. And that is patriotism and a love of our country. I've been asked about this election many times, and I say, tell people, we have always had a smooth transition of power. We've always believed in a peaceful transition of power. We've always believed in our democracy, and we must do that today. And I think the president said it best when he said, we are all on one team the day after the election, and we're going to have to remember this. And as leaders, as many are in this room, really try our best to understand where people are coming from on both sides and go from there. And I think there's no one that knows that better than our soldiers. When they're out on the battlefield, they don't say, oh, you're a Democrat and you're a Republican, right? That doesn't happen. And our country is much bigger than that. And it's about patriotism that makes our veterans risk their lives for our nation, compels them to keep serving their communities. And that's what I thought I would focus on a little today, because no one knows this better than Rotarians, this idea of those veterans that have served on the battlefields, 360,000 in Minnesota, then continue their service when they get home. It doesn't end. Whether there's a teacher, whether they're a volunteer, whether they coach a little league team, whether they are helping our office as we look at academy nominations, I just see it all the time. And so yesterday, General Shelato and I, or now Commissioner Shelato and I, got to, and thank you, good to be here with you, General, we got to give a Silver Star to a guy named Kenneth Hughes, and he served in Vietnam, and it reminded me of this idea of service. He was a medic in the Vietnam War, and in March of 1969, his unit took on heavy fire and was overrun by the Viet Cong. And many of his fellow soldiers were injured or killed, and he, without orders to do so, ran right into the firefight to try to treat and save their lives. And as he was doing this, he actually got shot in the left arm. And there were some of his buddies were there, including a guy named Buddy, kind of like Gumper. Yesterday, when we were in front of the State Vietnam Memorial, and they verified that all this happened, he was shot in the left arm, and he kept treating his fellow soldiers with his right hand, right in there in the battlefield. He then got shot in the chest, and he had to be carried away to this makeshift area where he actually declined morphine so that he could keep talking down and keeping people going who had been injured, because he knew what to do and he knew what to say. So I told that whole story as we're giving him this medal, and then I went over and stood by him, and I think Shelato was talking, and he turns to me. He's now a doctor. He has been a doctor for 50 years, came back, got his medical degree on the GI benefits, been helping and serving patients as a general practitioner in the Midwest. So we're standing there, and he goes, and everything he said was true. It was true.
And I said, hey, he goes, there's one little nuance, one thing. He said, you know when I declined the morphine? I said, yeah. He goes, I did want to keep talking to the soldiers, but also I was the only medic there, and I was afraid they'd screw it up and kill me. And I go, well, I don't actually think I need to go back to the microphone and explain that, but thank you. So that is a great story, though, of this Kenneth Hughes, a doctor who didn't let his service end when he was on the battlefield, right? He came home and he kept serving, and it is something we see all the time. It's something we see in our members of Congress, Tim Walz, who served in the military, and John Klein. And I thought I'd mention John because he is retiring this year, and before being elected to Congress, he was a 25-year career commissioned officer in the Marine Corps, and he and I have worked together extensively, especially on National Guard issues and benefit issues, and he's been a good friend. And I just think that's one example, but we see it every single day of every veteran in this room. And it may just be their second nature to serve, but that doesn't mean it's easy. And I think one of the things we've seen in recent years, especially coming out of the Afghan and Iraq wars, is that we have a lot of veterans that came back, especially right after the downturn, that actually didn't have a job even waiting for them so they could serve. And that, in addition to traumatic brain injury and some of the mental health issues we've seen, have made it much harder for them when they come home. And so we have really focused on this issue in our state under Governor Pawlenty and now Governor Dayton in terms of working with our employers to make sure beyond the yellow ribbons in place, as well as all of these job programs, our companies have risen to the challenge. And we've actually had people go out when our troops were serving, like in Kuwait, and people did talk to them about jobs and recruited them for jobs while they were still serving. And we've done a lot, as you know, on the federal level of trying to up the funding, the biggest funding increase in the history of the country, percentage-wise, after Iraq and Afghanistan. For the VA, and we continue to have issues there with wait lines and other things. Senator Joni Ernst and I have a bill to speed up the ability to get appointments, the medical appointments, because it's just been taking too long for some of our veterans. I just believe that when our soldiers signed up, there wasn't a waiting line when they sign up to serve our country and when they come home. There shouldn't be a waiting line in the United States of America, not for a home, not for a job, not for health care, not for education. And so that's a philosophy that we've tried to use, because if they're going to continue serving when they come home, then we have to continue serving them. So that has been a lot of the philosophy I've had when it comes to veterans issues, and it's been one of the few areas where we're able to work across the aisle every single day. I mentioned Vietnam vets, and I think one of the things that's changed over the years because of those veterans is that people have realized, I think especially apropos after this election, is that you can have disagreements about policy, you can even have disagreements about military policy and war policy, but you never take it out on our veterans on the front line. And that's certainly something we learned from the experience of our Vietnam vets, who when they came home, they weren't always greeted by balloons, they were greeted by tomatoes. Senator McCain has shared with me a lot of these stories over the years and what he witnessed and saw after serving so bravely. I went with him to Vietnam, stood outside of that cell where he had been held, and saw firsthand that kind of patriotism. And so I think that's another change that we've had, is that kind of respect. So really my simple message today is that we have been through one of the most difficult elections ever, and we have to get on the other side of it. And I think we can learn a little lesson from the election involving one of our great veterans, President Eisenhower. And in fact, I did a little research on this, and back in 1952, he was running against Adlai Stevenson. Eisenhower easily won that election, and it was a lot less contentious. Like, I didn't think they had like negative ads, right? Okay, maybe they did, but they weren't the kind we're seeing now. During that election, which took place only 14 years after Veterans Day, had become a national holiday, only 7 years after World War II ended, at a time when millions of veterans were using the GI Bill benefits, both of the presidential candidates were veterans themselves, and maybe that led to this different tone.
but they were rightly focused on serving the military. And when you look at that election, there was a really amazing quote, and it actually came from Adlai Stevenson. And he said this, "Men who have offered their lives for their country know that patriotism is not the fear of something, it is the love of something. It is not a short, frenzied outburst of emotion, but the steady dedication of a lifetime." And I just thought those words encapsulated what we are talking about here, is that we have so many bursts of emotion right now in our politics and in our discourse, but if you really want to be dedicated to people you serve, whether if you're in politics or whether you're in the military, it is looking at that arc of a lifetime. It is looking at what you do on the battlefield and then what you do when you come home. And we know that patriotism, true patriotism, isn't fleeting. It's something we must live every day. And that was what I thought of yesterday with Dr. Kenneth Hughes. So we must always remember that this patriotism doesn't end and our service doesn't end, it's forever. So I wanna thank those veterans that are here today for including me in this really beautiful program and hope that we will have a good weekend, that the sun will continue to shine, and that you will all enjoy the day today. So thank you very much, and thank you to our veterans. Thank you. Thank you,
Doctor. Thank you so much.
A word that's often lacking in politics is civility. Now you see why Democrats, Republicans, Independents alike love our United States Senator, Amy Klobuchar. Thank you so much for being here. We are deeply honored. And now we are going to hear again from our Rotary Brass Quintet. And they're just now getting their music together. They're going to play all the service songs. And so we would like each person who has served in any branch of service, when your song is played, please stand up so we can recognize you and give you the applause that you so richly deserve. Mary, take it away. Thank you. Brass Quintet. Appreciate it. And now, would all of the veterans in the room stand up at one time so we can see who you are and thank you for your service. I gave a speech a couple of weeks ago to a group of about 300 young business executives. They were in their 30s primarily. I asked them, how many of you have served in the military? Three hands went up. Not because they weren't patriotic people, but because our military has changed dramatically over the years. We now have a much smaller military, but it's very highly educated. And it's a military that relies on high technology, fewer people, but well-educated, well-trained people. We also relied on our guard and our reserve. When I first joined, if you were to ask any general, any admiral, about our guard or reserve, they would say, ah, they're weekend warriors, they're good people, but they're using war surplus equipment. And if we have a national emergency, they might be of some help to us, given some training and some good equipment. Today, if you go to the Pentagon, and I do that often, and you talk to any general or any admiral, they will tell you that we absolutely cannot provide national defense without our Guard and Reserve. About 40% of our national defense is in the Guard and Reserve. You don't know the difference. When they're out in the field, they have the same equipment, the same training, and you don't know if this is a guard person, a reserve person, or an active duty person. Well, today we have our speaker, is a leader of our Air National Guard. Brigadier General Sandy Best is the chief of staff of the entire Minnesota Air National Guard. The Air National Guard is all the fighter planes up in Duluth, and all of the C-130s at Fort Snelling. Oh, by the way, she also was the first female general in the National Guard. Remember that terrible day on 9/11, 2001. America was under attack. All airplanes had been grounded, except for a few. When you looked up in the air, you saw a couple of F-16s. Those F-16s were there to shoot down any plane that would be threatening our area. They were Air National Guard people from Duluth, Minnesota, part of Sandy's command. When you see now Minnesota people being deployed and sent overseas, and they're climbing on a C-130 with equipment, with people, they're coming from Fort Snelling from the Air National Guard, Sandy's command. The Guard and the Reserve are critical for our defense. Sandy was an enlisted member for a while and then became an officer. And as I said, she's the first female general in Minnesota. As is every general, she's highly educated. She has her BA in Human Resources, her MBA in Management from St. Thomas University. She graduated from Air War College, which is the equivalent of the PhD for military people. She was a policy fellow at the University of Minnesota, and she completed the program for Homeland Security at Harvard University. She comes from a very proud military family. Her husband, Steve, with us today, is a retired member of the Air Force. She has two daughters who served in the military. One is still serving. Her two younger daughters are in college. Oh, and by the way, her dad was in the military, and so was her grandfather. So when she said, I'm part of a proud military family, she's not just kidding. She made history as the first female general in Minnesota. Don't be too surprised if she isn't the first female adjutant general from Minnesota. Please welcome General Sandy Best.
Well, good afternoon, Senator Klobuchar, state senators and representatives, mayors, council members, business leaders, Rotarians, Rotary Brass Band, ladies and gentlemen, and a special welcome to our honorees, veterans. Thank you for inviting me to your Southwest Suburbs Rotary Veterans Day lunch. I want to especially thank Brigadier General retired Denny Shulsted for providing the opportunity. This is my initial visit to Bear Path Country Club. It's beautiful. An extraordinary venue carrying the signature of golf's greatest golfer, honoring America's greatest asset, our veterans. Thank you all for being here and joining me on the one day we set aside to pay tribute to our vets, reflect on and acknowledge their sacrifices, and also, and perhaps most importantly, a time to celebrate their service and triumphs. This day, Veterans Day, formerly known as Armistice Day, is so special to so many people, it's difficult to say something meaningful that has not been said and heard countless times before. It is clear you did not come here for a history lesson on the origins of Veterans Day. I'm sure many of you know it better than I. So I am going to relate briefly what this day means to my family and me. My family, as well as my husband's, are proud of our rich tradition of military service. As a result, Veterans Day has always been a special day for us, as I'm sure it is for each of you. I'd like to briefly tell you a story about a veteran from World War I. My husband's grandfather was a dairy farmer in north central Wisconsin. On July 8, 1918, he received a letter from the St. Croix County Selective Service that his farm deferment had been canceled and he needed to report to Camp Grant, Illinois by rail. He was representative of all servicemen, past and present. They put their lives and careers on hold and reported for duty regardless of the hardship. He deployed to France and experienced the horror of warfare in Meuse-Argonne offensive, in which nearly 1.2 million American soldiers fought from September 26, 1918 until the war ended on Armistice, November 11, 1918. So for him, the war was brief, but he was forever changed. He was discharged and went back to farming, but for him, Armistice Day, the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month, was a day he held sacred. It was the one and only day of the year he would milk cows in the morning and then would quietly reflect and remember until it was time to milk cows again in the evening. Fast forward 65 years. My husband is a superintendent of operations in the Air Force at a remote site in the high north plains of Turkey. About 50 other servicemen members, men and women, rotate through this site for a one-year tour. Remote sites were and remain austere places where family living is just simply not suitable. My husband relates the story of a young female airman newly assigned who had just given birth in the States 6 weeks earlier. Her permanent change of station orders were firm. She understood her duty and had to report to the remote site. Sadly, she had to leave her newborn home with her mother because her husband, also a military member, was assigned to a remote site on the other side of the world. Imagine having a new baby and having to give it up for an entire year. That is service to our country. These are but two stories that span generations, but one thing rings true and is representative of the veterans we honor today, and that is absolute service to our country. It's said in many ways, service before self, the mission comes first, or in the words of President John F. Kennedy, ask not what your country can do for you, but what you can do for your country. Simply said, we honor those veterans today who, through love of country, recognize their duty to protect and defend the Constitution against all enemies, both foreign and domestic. You know this day, Veterans Day, is to recognize our veterans that have sacrificed mightily. But I think, and I would guess that no one would disagree, that we should also recognize the veteran's family who has borne equal sacrifice. For example, in 2008-2009, I was deployed to Bagram Airfield, Afghanistan. One daughter was in middle school and one in high school. They are both great kids, but were facing teenage challenges that most families face to some degree or another. The bottom line is they needed me, but they also knew and accepted and actually shouldered a responsibility of service themselves by allowing me to the freedom to step forward and deploy with peace of mind, knowing that they fully supported me. These stories are typical of our veterans and their families now and generations ago. That is why for two centuries, we have been able to enjoy our inalienable right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. One of the most significant changes in our military today is that so many more women are serving, and serving in nearly every capacity. Of nearly 11,000 Army National Guard in Minnesota, 17.5%, or 1,925, are women. Of over 2,200 Air National Guard in Minnesota, 22.8%, or 502, are women. In comparison to the National Guard overall and the active service components, the Minnesota Army National Guard and the Minnesota Air National Guard gender statistics are higher. We still have room for improvement to close the gap towards our state demographic of 50%. As Secretary of the Air Force, Deborah Lee James, and Secretary of the Army, Eric Fanning, continue to espouse, diversity is critical to the future of our military. It's increasingly common for husbands and wives to both be serving at the same time, which can increase stressors on these families. And let's face it, whether you are a man or a woman, we can all use support getting through challenging times on occasion. That is why we are so fortunate that Minnesota leads the nation with our Beyond the Yellow Ribbon program. Beyond the Yellow Ribbon is a comprehensive program that increases awareness for the purpose of connecting service members and their families with community support, training, services, and resources. 220 cities, 26 counties, and 52 businesses have been proclaimed Beyond the Yellow Ribbon communities, recognizing their support of service members and their families in Minnesota. I'm so pleased that Minnesotans show such strong support of our veterans. I'm pleased that as a nation, we appreciate our veterans. Thank God the days of Vietnam and the poor way we treated our veterans is behind us. In the words of George Washington, the willingness with which our young people are likely to serve in any war, no matter how justified, shall be directly proportional to how they perceive the veterans of earlier wars were treated and appreciated by their nations. Today, Thankfully, we recognize the heroic self-sacrifice of all veterans. As a nation, we now recognize that the circumstances in which they fought are not nearly as important as the selfless service to our nation. We separate the politics of America's wars from its participants and demand that our vets receive the health care and treatment they've earned. On this day, we recognize that the veterans of all of our nation's wars, from our revolution to World War I and World War II, Korea, Vietnam, Desert Shield, Desert Storm, Iraq, and Afghanistan, all share the same blood and the same sacrifice. Whether our service members fought the Taliban in Afghanistan, Ebola in West Africa, or floods in Minnesota, they forever share the same bond. Today is their day, it's your day. While Memorial Day is a time of somber silence, Veterans Day is a time of triumph. Today, let us cover ourselves in joy and festivity as we remember that what our veterans do for us. Thank you, veterans and family members, for your service. God bless our veterans, our servicemen and women, our leaders, our citizens, and always God bless our nation, the United States of America. Thank you.
Thank you, General Best. What a good name. You're the best. As a token of our gratitude, the Rotary Clubs are sending a donation in your name to the Minnesotans Military Appreciation Fund. For those of you who don't know about this Appreciation Fund, it's a group that has raised about $17 million. We give $500 and a letter of appreciation to every young man and woman from Minnesota who has served in a combat area after 9/11. We give up to $10,000 for those who were injured in the line of duty. We are the only state in the United States of America doing something like this, and we have given 14,000 grants so far. So thank you. Rotary is made up of 1.2 million people in 165 nations. They are community leaders. They're working together for lasting change in our communities and around the world. You can all be very proud to be Rotarians. Now, to close the program, we want to recognize and thank some of those who made the program so special and inspirational. General Sandy Best, thank you very much. The Chanhassen American Legion Post, thank you. And of course, our own brass quintet. But significant work is done to plan a program like this. And that work is done by the president-elect from the 8 Southwest Metro Rotary Clubs. They did all of that work and they worked very hard on it. I would like them, hold your applause please, I would like all of those to stand who are the presidents-elect from the different Rotary Clubs. Please stand. Okay. And I would like to give special thanks to Kim Ross, who chaired the effort. She made all of the rest of us look good while she was doing all of the work. So thank you very much. Now, please, take a round of applause. And now, if you would please stand, we will ask the Chanhassen American Legion Post to retire the colors.
Retrieve the colors. Retire the colors. Left face. Forward march. Left. Left.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for being with us today, and to all of the veterans in the room, thank you for your service.